Finally, it is my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Iris Bohnet. Iris is a professor of public policy here at Harvard Kennedy School and is also the director of the Women and Public Policy Program. She is a behavioral economist, and her research combines insights from economics and psychology. This year, she is teaching a new course on closing the global gender gap, together with Rohini Panda. For those of you who may be interested in the class, there are copies of the syllabus available on the table, and the first meeting of the course will take place next Wednesday, September 15th, at 4 o'clock here in this room. And now I am pleased to turn the floor over to Iris Bohnet, who will be speaking to us today about gender equality nudges.
Thanks so much. And thank you all for coming, and my apologies to those who have to stand, but this is a particularly exciting moment for us because this is the inaugural event in our new seminar room. This is brand new, the first seminar taking place here, so it had to be. Okay, so I want to talk about the gender equality nudges today, and first I wanted to give you a bit bigger picture of how I think about this. So my talk is about how to close gender gaps. And there's, of course, many different ways that we could close gender gaps. For example, I'm an economist by training, you could use incentives. And that's what we often do. So if parents don't send their daughters to school, we can offer them cash to send their daughters to school. And that has been done, and it's pretty effective. We can also regulate. For example, many companies now, boards in Norway, and few governments, including India, have introduced quotas for women to be represented in leadership positions. Norway, you probably know, has a quota of 40% for women on boards. There's also now a few companies. Deutsche Telekom is the largest company now, who has just introduced this year a 30% quota for women in leadership positions by 2015. So that's regulation. That's how you can intervene as well. And then you can provide information. In fact, in the second part of the talk, I will also talk a little bit about information. So what difference does information make? But I'm going to start by talking about nudges. And some of you may have heard of this concept. I'm going to give you an illustration in just a second. It's a wonderful book by Richard Thaler and Cass Sunstein called Nudge. Talking more broadly, not specifically regarding gender, but talking more broadly about how you could intervene, taking insights from psychology about how our minds work seriously and change people's behavior. So nudges are, for people like you and me, who I presume are somewhat self-selected because you're here, so for people who kind of want to do the right thing, do not want to discriminate people based on some demographic characteristics, but can't always do it because of the cognitive limitations that we are born with. So I'm not making an argument that there aren't people out there, not in this room, who are steadfast against gender equality. We all know about Gendercide, a recent economist covered TED paper, as you probably recall. We do know that some preference is very prevalent in certain parts of the world. Now, 120 boys for 100 girls, for example, in India and certain parts of China. So there are people who do not want to have gender equality. But nudges are kind of for the rest of us. We kind of want to do the right thing, but somehow don't get quite around to doing it. Because of bounds on our rationality, bounds on our willpower, and bounds on our awareness. We may not be totally aware of certain things. So that's kind of the concept that I want to talk about. And to illustrate that, I want to give you a short little example here, which at the surface doesn't have anything to do with gender. Namely, I would like for you to look at squares A and B here, and compare A and B. When I do that in my class or with executives, I ask people to describe these squares to me, and most everyone in this room will perceive square B as lighter than square A. Because your minds make sense of the pattern here, and you're also taking into account that there may be a little shadow here, which makes it a little darker. Turns out this is an illusion. When I cover, and I don't do anything else, I promise, when I cover the rest of these squares, you will see how B gets darker and darker, and actually now it looks identical to A, and it was identical to A all the time. So what we perceive as same or different, as light or dark, as leadership, as follower, as young, old, attractive, not, is all available. And there's a lot of illusions that will cloud our judgment. So that's my starting point. And one more starting point, and then I'm going to start with my first study here. One more starting point that I want to give to you. Another very nice exercise is this one here. And again, I'm not going to be doing it, but I want to give you the sense of it. So here's how this exercise works. I would ask you to tell me what color you see. And in fact, that would take the time, how long it takes it to read through all these colors. So you would say, green, red, blue, orange, this is a little yellow, sorry, orange, pink, orange, etc. And that would take you maybe 18 seconds. And then I would compare the speed with which you do this with this little task here. So now, I would again ask you to tell me what color you see, and you would say yellow or orange, and you would say blue, and you would say pink, and you would realize immediately that it's very different. It normally takes groups about twice as long, and typically they give up in a minute. And I have to tell you, by the way, the bad news is my 4-year-old son who can't read is much faster than any of you. So this is an illustration of something that has led to a much larger research agenda on implicit associations. And what this does is it says that certain associations come very natural to us. Like, when it is green, it should say green, and we're very fast at picking that up. But they're, of course, looking at other types of associations, like woman and leadership, or man and diapers, or they look at all kinds of demographic characteristics. They look at race, they look at gender, they look at nationalities, they look at religion. And they're arguing that that is one way to measure our implicit biases, namely by how long it takes to make those associations. And here at Harvard, this program is led by Professor Mazarin Bonacci at the Harvard Psychology Department. And you could log in to this webpage here, take your own test, and see that we all are sexist and racist and nationalist, unfortunately. Okay, so now let me talk about three studies. And you will see the first study, I'm actually just going to give you an idea. That's a study we haven't yet conducted, but one that we wanted to conduct. Just to give you an idea, because it's a nice illustration of a nudge. Then I want to talk about a study that is very advanced, together with Max Bazerman, who's sitting back there, and Alexandra van Geen, who's sitting right here. And then, so that's going to be the second study, and then the third study is a joint study with Farsad Saidi, who's sitting next to Max. So here's the first study. So this is choosing one at a time, something that Alexandra and I are particularly interested in. But here's the question, or the idea. There's research out there in psychology which hasn't looked at gender, but which has looked at the following question. Do people choose differently when they make simultaneous choices as compared to sequential choices? And let me give you an example so that this becomes clear. So one of the earliest studies by Simonson wasn't exactly like this, but went something like this. Students were asked to make choices for snacks. And they were asked in one condition at the beginning of the month to choose 30 snacks for every day of the month. Okay? So you have lots of snacks at your disposal, and you choose one snack for every day of the month. And then they compared that behavior where students were asked every morning of the month to choose a snack. Okay, so 30 snacks every day. Turns out that if you decide every day, and that's sequentially, you will be much more likely to go for the same favorite snack. When you choose 30 snacks, you cannot just can't do Swiss chocolate bar, although I would have lots of empathy for that. But you know, being Swiss and loving chocolate. But you just can't do 30 Swiss chocolate bars. But you grow like an apple and a chocolate bar, cereal bar, and this or that. So people choose variety. So this is known as variety seeking when you make simultaneous choices. So Alexander and I want to apply this to hiring decisions. What if you hire in bundles rather than one at a time? Wouldn't you much more naturally look for diversity when you have to hire 5 new assistant professors, for example, at the same time, rather than sequentially over a year or two, when it will always, you will be inclined to want to go with what you typically choose, what you naturally choose, which may be close to who you yourself are, etc. So that's what we want to look at. So that would be a nudge. That would be a nudge. We're nudging the environment. And of course, it would have to be an organization which wants to be more gender equal. Which kind of as a goal wants to be more gender equal. And then we can slightly change the selection process to make it more likely that diverse choices will result. Okay. So,
can we ask questions?
I think maybe later, okay. If that's okay. That's okay. I think I'm going to stop after this study because this is closely related to the first study and then take comments. Is that okay? Okay. So this is a study that we call Evaluating One at a Time. It's not the final title, which closely builds on earlier work by Max, Bazerman, and others, which has looked at separate versus joint evaluation. And you will see it will seem somewhat related to the first approach, but still quite different. So here, the basic idea is, and I'm going to walk you through the design in just a second. And the basic idea is that sometimes we evaluate one person at a time and don't really have comparison information easily available. Will I behave differently if I focus on one person at a time, or one object at a time, it doesn't have to be a person, as compared to when I evaluate 2 objects or 2 people simultaneously? So let me walk you through the study that we actually conducted. So this is an experimental study that we ran in the Harvard Decision Science Laboratory. We have Mark Eddington here, its executive director. It's a beautiful lab that Kennedy School and Harvard have recently built. And here's what we did. We had a first stage where people came into the lab and participated in a task. We call these people agents. Think of these people as potential employees. So you will be in the second stage, you will be the employers. So I'll talk to you in just a second. But now, your employees, potential employees, come in and do a task. In fact, they participate either in a verbal task or a math task. And I'll introduce the task in just a little bit. And they do this for a few rounds, and then are paid for performance and leave. And right now, I'm not particularly interested in them, but we need their data for now. And importantly, we have the same number of men and women. So now, you come into the lab. You are, we call you the principals. You are the employers, potential employers. And you receive information on these agents' performance. Okay. So they participated in the experiment twice. And so we give you information on the performance level in the first round. And in addition, we give you some information on their demographic characteristics. In fact, importantly, we give you information on their gender, but we don't want to make gender too salient. So what we do is we mask gender by giving you 5 other pieces of information on them, which are identical for everyone. So for example, that includes this person is a student, this person lives in the Boston area, this person is between 18 and 25 years old. Information that is absolutely identical for all of the candidates, but you don't know. But we only vary gender. So some of you will see performance information on a candidate, on a job candidate, and she's a woman. And some of you will see information on a job candidate, and he's a man. So that's the basic design. And then, importantly, we have these treatment conditions. As you will see, it's a slightly complicated design, 2x2x2. We have these treatment conditions. So in a separate condition, you, the principal, receives information on one agent only. That's the situation I just described. So you learn the applicant is either male or female, and you learn whether the performance of that person was either high or low in the first round. And when I say high or low, I'm exaggerating a little bit, because actually the difference is only 1 point. In fact, the information of the high performer, that's important for us, kind of technically speaking, for the experiment, but is at the mean of everyone else. So you get that information, and that's a separate condition. Another group, so not you, another group of potential employers, choosers here, received the following information. They received information on two candidates at the same time. So now they receive information on a male and a female candidate, and on the performance of these people in round one. So let me show you the design, because it's slightly complicated. So we have either male or female candidates. And these are either high performers or low performers. And you know this, right? That's previous round information. And imagine that's kind of what you have as an applicant, too. As a future employer, you kind of know something about how that person performed. You know their gender. You know other things. But in our study, that's not important. Then in addition, you evaluate them either separately. These are the darker colors, and that doesn't quite show here, but that has a color too. The darker colors here, you evaluate one at a time, or you evaluate them jointly, okay? And so, for example, in this case here, in the yellow half square here, triangle, in other words, is a high-performing male. And then the question we ask you is, do you want to hire the high-performing male? And hiring means you will be paid based on that person's second round performance in the future. And so you're hiring a person, and your incentives are to hire someone who's going to give you lots of rewards. But that's what hiring means. So you could either hire the person, or, importantly, you could go back to the pool, in which case you would pick someone randomly from the 40 women and from the 40 men. And that person's performance will determine your payoff. Now, you know that the average performance in the whole group was 10 scores, which is true, and you also know what the minimum performance level was and the maximum performance level. And so you kind of can gauge, should I take the risk, should I go with the random sample here, or should I pick this particular candidate? And of course, we are particularly interested in whether there are any gender differences. Right? This is the same performance level here in the yellow and the light blue, with the only difference that it's a man or a woman. In the joint condition here, for example, you get performance on the high-performing man and on the low-performing woman. And the question is, does that comparison information make you more rational? That would be the theoretical argument. It now will focus your attention more on the more objective information that we provide to you, namely performance. Is that happening? So that's what we're trying to find out. So we would expect differences here which go along gender stereotypes, that if you have only the male candidate or the female candidate, you will base your decision on stereotypes. But if you have comparison information available here, or down here for that matter, you will focus your decision more on the performance level and gender will become less important. So, some information on the tasks. We have a math task. So we have stereotypically male and stereotypically female tasks. Where in the math task, people have to add up 5 two-digit numbers. These are kind of the agents, so the potential people who you can employ. As I said, 40%, I already said, so we don't have to talk about that. We don't find any significant gender differences in their performance, by the way. Although, men are slightly better, but not significantly better, just ever so slightly. And then we have principals here who choose these people. And then the verbal task is finding words in a word find task. Okay, so here is, and women are slightly better, but not significantly better again. So this is a typical task. So for example, this is nations of the world. In fact, our participants were also given a list of the nations that they had to look for. And for example, down here, you know, for example, Singapore. So, this is a task that Farsad developed and programmed with our programmer in the lab together, where you can mark the words on the screen and you can find as many as 20 words. And you actually have a list of all possible nations next to the screen. Okay, so that's the word find task. Okay, results. And then I'm going to open up for comments and questions before I move on to the next slide. So this is now the math task. And what I'm showing you is the likelihood that the candidate is chosen. So you see here that people choose a high-performing man 66% of the time. But they choose the same high-performing woman only 44% of the time. Meaning that they must base their decision also on gender stereotypes, which conform with the mass stereotypes out there. We see the same kind of gender difference in low, although you might be surprised that the lows are still so high. We were kind of surprised by that, but the gender gap is there. Okay, now let's look at the joint evaluation. Gender differences just go away. You're now comparing the high-performing man with the low-performing woman. You decide, do I want to choose that man? Do I want to choose the low-performing woman, or do I want to choose randomly? And you see that likelihood is identical, independent of whether you're a high-performing man or a high-performing woman. You certainly, there's also some other main effect. You certainly don't want to be a low-performing person and be in the joint evaluation. Right? That means you are not chosen. So that's now all the results together. So gender differences in separate and not in joint. I'm going to open up in just one more minute, literally. So I want to just sort of the verbal tasks. So this is now the verbal task, right? Everything identical, just different tasks. You see a reversal. So now women are more likely to be chosen than men. Although, I want to note that the likelihood that a man is chosen in math or verbal is always around 65%. You may recall from before, that was 66%. It's really the women who are driving our differences here. So women are punished or chosen, less likely to be chosen in math, but benefit from the verbal test. Look at that, so it's 81% versus 44%. And you get the same for the low performing people. And that's joint now, and the differences go away again. So in joint evaluation, it just no gender difference at all. And this is the whole thing today. Okay, comments, questions?
Just a clarification here.
Yes, please, Michael.
When you're looking at the joint, is the pair a high-performing man and a high-performing woman, or a high-performing man and a low-performing
man? A high-performing man and a low-performing woman.
And vice versa.
And vice versa. That's vice versa. Right, exactly.
So why don't you always hire the high-performing person?
Sorry. Yeah, I know we have Kennedy School too, but. But that's exactly our question, right? That sometimes gender stereotypes matter. Now, I'm going to say one more word. This is not necessarily irrational yet. Here's why. If gender is predictive of future behavior, you might interpret the high-performing woman as, oh, she was lucky in the last round in math. Women generally aren't doing well in math, so of course I'm not going to choose her because she's probably not going to be doing as well in the next round again. I'm going to go for the man. So therefore, right now, what we're doing is, which is a very harsh test. I mean, I can't believe this is going to work, but we'll know soon. Alexandra's still collecting data, so she's smiling. We'll do for same round comparison. So you're not making predictions about the future, but the person scored 10, she's female, do you want to be paid according to her performance now, or do you want to go random? So now we can exclude any statistical discrimination. Because here, as I said, there's this potential, it doesn't have to be irrational. Sorry, yes?
Three very quick questions. Firstly, in the variety seeking, is it the preference for variety, or is it just simply time inconsistency? And secondly, what do you think would happen if you had comparisons in pairs with high-performing women, high-performing men, instead of having one high, one low? Does that type of variety also make you more objective or not? And thirdly, what difference does the gender of the principal make?
Okay, so I'm going to start backwards. The gender of the chooser doesn't make a difference. That's, by the way, not rare. Very often we find in studies that these stereotypes are shared by all of us. We're all products of the society, so often it's not the case that women discriminate more or less than men. Although, I know there's some other, but that's kind of the typical result. Time inconsistency, total. So we will exclude time inconsistency. In the previous studies, they tried to control for that, I'm completely with you. So the question is about when I decide in the morning, the consumption is going to be immediate in 2 hours. And we know people have very strong preference, a bias for now, for consumptions now. So I'm going to be very smart about, you know, dieting in the future and jogging in the future and doing this and that in the future. But right now, I need to jog more. So that's totally possible. We won't have that in our design. We won't have that. But that's general. That's been a question in the literature, in that variety seeking literature. Mm-hmm. They went back and forth and that and tried to contract time. And
but it's generally seen as the same, or
it's one big. It's not the only reason why variety seeking happens, but it's one important reason for variety seeking happens. Now I forgot the middle question.
If you instead have.
Oh right, hi. Mm-hmm. So I don't know, and we're right now just debating: do we need to run more treatment? Not more treatment. So another question is: what if it's the same sex but different performance levels? Right? So you have a high male and a low male. What is that going to do? I mean, I cannot imagine that that's just not going to lead people to choose the high male. No, or high female. I mean, we wanted to create some conflict for people, right? That performance levels would suggest to go with the counter-stereotypic choice. So that's why we were interested in crossing these. So we haven't done either your suggestion or the one that I just talked about, and honestly don't know yet. But maybe you can talk afterwards. Whether we need to or should be, or what exactly we do. But I don't know. No?
I was no? just going to add a vote for having the high is a good idea, to be able to figure out whether it's really a comparison that's driving it, or this idea of maybe feeling more like, oh, it could get much worse. So.
Right. Okay, so then we can, some implications here, then I'm gonna talk about the second study. So there's actually many people who benefit from separate evaluation. So that's kind of why I have this here. So separate was generally kind of the darker color. So if you have a positively stereotyped group, right, separate is great. If you are a low performer, separate is great. You certainly don't want to be compared with high performer. That's a very, very strong result. It's not particularly surprising, but that's good. If you're a negatively stereotyped group, it is bad for women in math. So women in math prefer joint evaluation. That's when performance really kicks in. However, even for men in verbal, they're actually doing quite fine in separate. That's what I said before. Look at the men here. The men are doing worse than the women. Separately evaluated men are doing worse than the women, but and that's actually not a significant difference in result, but as well as in joint. So what about high performers? So again, for women in math, they want to have joint because they want to be based, they want decisions to be based on their performance level, not on their gender. And for women in wearable, it goes if they're supposed to stereotype. So there's a lot of separate here. But if you look at the organization, and that's actually what we're really interested in, and what we want to also fine-tune, is if the organization was interested in maximizing performance, right, they would like to have a human resource manager or employer or whoever evaluates a candidate to choose the highest performer, irrespective of gender. Of course, if the organization is interested in gender equality, they would also want that. But it's the organization which is interested in joint, but lots of, so to speak, pressure groups, which find it quite advantageous to be evaluated. Okay, any questions, comments on this? Otherwise I will move on to another step.
Pretty much, men consistently want to be separately evaluated.
In our study, I don't think that, I don't know whether that's generalizable, but that's exactly what we found. That men in math are not really punished. Men in verbal, are not really punished. Yes, but then it's actually, and I don't know, but have to read up on that. Maybe someone knows. I seem to remember that differences between groups are often driven by the tradition of discriminating against groups. So it's not just true for gender, but it's also true for race. But it's something I have to learn more about. But I don't think that's so surprising that our differences are mainly driven by women, because it's often, just to give you the intuition behind that, the salient group in this room is the minority group. It happens to be men today. So often results are more driven by kind of that the focal group minority. But that's, you know, I don't know here. That's the speculation. Okay. So, and now I want to focus a bit more on the role of information and want to talk about groups. And now I want to talk about the performance of groups, in fact, directly related to my example, performance of the minority group and the majority group in a larger team. And Farsad and I are arguing that one potential mechanism that might lead to performance differences between the majority group and the minority group are informational differences. And before I walk you through our study, let me give you the intuition. The intuition is that we all learn from each other. And some of what we learn is non-gender specific. But some that we pick up and learn is gender specific or more generally group specific. So let me talk from my own profession. As a young woman, female assistant professor, in a faculty meeting, you learn from what other faculty do. And same for you, students in the classroom. But you also pay particular attention to other women faculty. How do they dress? How often do they speak? Do they criticize the dean? Is it good to speak a lot? Should you not? So there's certain cues that you take from people like yourself. So that's the intuition behind it. However, if your sample is small, and this is not just a statistical argument, nothing else. If your sample is small, let's assume 500 men in the room here. The information you get is noisy by definition. Because one man will always speak, another one will sleep, the third one didn't even appear, and the fourth one, you know, this or that, compared to women who have a sample of 50, which by statistical necessity has to be a much cleaner sample. So what I learned from 50 is much more representative of what's going on for women in the room as compared to what you men pick up from the five other men in the room, what is going on. So that's the intuition behind it. So what we're saying is that as the minority group, you're informationally disadvantaged because you have fewer people to learn from. And as a majority group, you're informationally advantaged. In fact, there's a lot of evidence that mentoring relationships and networks in organizations are most effective and typically happen, also descriptively, along the same gender or racial or even nationality lines. But you tend to naturally be drawn to people like yourself. So that's what we want to test in the lab. Is it true? Are informationally disadvantaged people going to perform worse than informationally advantaged people? Yes.
Just a clarification. Are you talking about the more people, the more amount of information, or the more sure you are that this is the, you know, it's a variance issue that you're...
It's a variance issue, yes. The more people, the larger your sample, right, the smaller your variance.
Okay. So just confidence about what's right.
Exactly. The smaller your sample, the larger your variance. It's just, yes, it's the noise in the information. It's totally a variance, sorry. Okay, so now I'm going to talk a bit. So this is, I apologize, but I have to walk you through the framework that we actually use. So we have a very simple way of characterizing kind of what you do, a task that you do. So we're saying that the output that you produce in this task, think of the verbal task or the math task that we had before, that output has something to do with effort, so how much you put in, how hard you work, and some luck component. It's a very typical, very simple kind of way to describe this. And then we're assuming that you are in an incentive structure that we call a tournament. And here's how this works. Think of a law firm, for example, or for academia for that matter, where the incentives are you either are promoted to partner or you leave. Or you're promoted to full professor or you leave. So it's up or out. So that's a tournament. So you and I compete in our design. It's going to be two people competing for one big prize. And the winner of the tournament will get the big prize, and the loser of the tournament will get a small prize. pursuing risk neutrality, but just as for those of you who are interested in technicalities here. And then we're saying that the less precise the agency information is now, on the value of this luck component, the worse the person will perform. So we're saying that part of the reward that I get, or part of my understanding of how likely I am to be promoted to full professor, has to do with my effort. And part is some sort of random component that I don't quite understand. And for that, so part is I have to publish, and I have to teach well, and I have to do this and that. But part is kind of learning from others. So that's that luck component. The minority group, and that's really now kind of where we come in, the minority group will have less information on that. Okay, so other people have looked at this. It's not totally conclusive, actually. Some people find the results, some people don't. Not too many people have looked at this noise performance. And so our innovation really is to say that the noise, the degree of information, the precision of the information, or the variance, more technically, depends on the number of similar others available to learn from.
Yes. So the idea is that you can improve your luck performance by learning from others, by learning from your...
You cannot improve it, you will better understand it.
Okay.
It will become clear. So what we will do in the design is... I'll show it in the next slide. next slide, not this one. So here's just not a summary again. So the maturity group is better informed on this effort-reward relationship, therefore works harder, performs better. The minority group has worse information, therefore performs worse. I don't think I'll talk, I can't talk a little bit about that. This is now fine-tuning things. So this is the game theorists in us, and particularly Farsad, who's thinking this really through carefully and then says, okay, it also depends, we also have to take into account what we both know about each other. So let's assume we're completely ignorant, and I have no clue that you're better informed. That should, in our model, in our theoretical model, increase the gap. However, if we both knew about this, it might decrease the gap. It still exists, the gap, but it decreases. Here's why. So I know that Farsad, for example, is informationally advantaged, and I'm informationally disadvantaged. That might motivate me to work harder. Now I know I have a disadvantage already to start with, so I try harder. He, at the same time, as the majority group, and that's why this has real performance implications for an organization, might also understand, oh my God, I'm competing against these weak women who have no clue what's going on, so I can relax. So that's why the gap, if we all know about each other, would actually shrink. Now you will see, we actually had no significant difference, but just technically speaking. And then we'll find something else that I'll talk about, which is interesting. Okay, so here's the experimental design. So the output is the number of words you found in the word find task that I described to you before. That gives you your task score. So you might find 8 words, 8 points. Your final score is the task score plus, and that now gets to your question. A random bonus, and we call it bonus, which varies between X and Y. There's 4 rounds that we play, same pair. And then we vary the variance here. So we do a double check of variance. We want to see whether people at all are responsive to changes in variance of the bonus component. So in the first 2 rounds, that variance is large. In the second 2 rounds, that variance is smaller. And then the reward, as I said, tournament in pairs. The winner receives a large prize. In our case, it was $10. And the loser receives a small prize. In our case, it was $2. And people played this 4 rounds, so if you won every round, you would leave the lab with $40 plus $10 show-up fee, which is a very nice incentive in the lab. But if you lose, you leave the lab with $8 plus the show-up fee. So we're trying to make the incentives here kind of quite big. Okay, so this is the design, now the treatment conditions. And I think I've already talked about them, but just to summarize here, so agents either belong to the information advantaged group, that's the majority group, or the information disadvantaged group. So here's how this works. If you're information advantaged, come into the lab, you see the task, you hear everything that I just explained, and then we tell you, and there's this bonus value, and we know, you know, you don't exactly know what it's what it is, but the bonus value is in this hat. We have a hat on the screen, and there's 18 potential bonuses that you could get and we will draw 12 for you now. So you have a sample of 12 out of 18. The information disadvantaged groups get 3 draws. Right? So the one group knows pretty well what the bonus is, has a good sense of the bonus. We also ask them for the mean prediction. We also ask for confidence intervals to actually get a measure of variance. While the information disadvantaged groups doesn't have a good understanding.
So the second one is should be 3.
Sumi, did I, what did I say?
It's one.
Oh, I'm sorry, that's 2. Oh,
that's 3. Okay.
Sorry. Oh, yeah. That is copy paste. And not a, yeah, that's an anchoring and insufficient adjustment, I would say. Yeah, no, sorry about that. That should be 3. Totally. Sorry about that. Okay. So, and then we have these two, that's why it's 2x2 treatment conditions where either I'm competing with another small sample player or large sample player. I'm going to not call them large sample or small sample player. So I'm going to compete with someone like me. That's meaning homogeneous beliefs. That's where I have no clue of the world. I'm actually assuming everyone is like me. And to make sure people believe that, everyone is like me. Okay, so that's in the lab. So I'm either competing against another well-informed person or another badly informed person. And then in the mixed treatment here, we have pairs of one well and one badly informed person. So think, you know, women with women, men with men, men with women, women with women. Okay, so this is the experimental procedure. Subjects come into the lab. They can learn about what we're doing here. See whether I have to say anything else. I told you that we collect beliefs about the value of the bonus, the mean value, confidence intervals. I don't think anything else is. We also elicit risk preferences to control for whether risk aversion might affect people's behavior, demographic question. Okay. Any questions about the design? Because I'm now moving to results.
Yeah, if you move back one.
Yes.
Okay. If you inform them about X and Y, what additional information do they get from this sampling then?
They have no idea of the mean for the first moment. They only know it is between 0 and 100.
Oh, okay.
But no,
so
way
it's not
of knowing.
For
no, no, no.
Okay.
And we make that very clear.
Oh, okay.
We also make that very clear. Right. So they have no way of knowing the mean. And it actually is not 50. Other? Okay, so these are the results. So first of all, I show you something very, very straightforward. These are the scores, the distribution of all scores that people have. And what you see is, I mean, on average, people find about 10 words, and then we have very few, I think 4 participants who always find all 20 words, but other than that, everyone finds something, but it's kind of nicely distributed for us, with some variance here in behavior. Okay. And now comes basically the most important slide here, and that is, do we find a difference between the large sample group, the well-informed group, and the small sample group? And that difference is about 1.2 words. On average, which is seems maybe small or large, whatever you think, but is 1/3 of a standard deviation, which is quite significant. So this is the whole sample. So this is your large sample player. They find about 2.7 words or so, and then we have the small sample players who find about 10.7 words as compared to 9.6. And then here you have, I'm competing with people like me. So that difference goes down a little bit. And this is, I'm competing with someone who's different from me. So I want to note kind of 2 things. One is that the interaction here, that this difference here looks larger than this difference here, but it's not actually larger. However, it is opposite to the rational model that I described to you before. And I'll get back to that in just a moment, because there may be some interesting behavioral implications that some of you have, and the literature that I might not be aware of that we should take into consideration thinking about this. But anyway, it's also driven by the small sample players. So this looks like the small sample players are discouraged. They know that they are playing against someone who got an informational advantage. They don't work as hard anymore. Some regressions that I don't think I want to talk too much about now, those interested, I mean, we have a paper now. We do a two-stage regression here, and we instrument for, we actually want to see whether what they do is due to differences in perceptions of the variance. So we want to see whether the model is exactly right. And that's exactly what we found. So is that exactly people who perceive the variance as bigger perform worse? People who perceive the variance as smaller perform better. So I'm not going to bore you with that. Okay, here are our findings. So the performance gap is not smaller when information disadvantaged minority agent competes with information disadvantaged minority agent. That's what you just saw. But the rational model would have predicted the opposite. But the rational model would have said, now that I know that I'm disadvantaged, I'm going to try extra hard. That's not what happens. And I actually don't know that measure well, but I'm sure there must be, as always, when economists do something that psychologists have already studied before, there must be psychological literature about this discouragement effect. That now I'm competing with a man who is advantaged, has more information available, and kind of giving up. It's an exaggeration of what we find, but that's kind of, you know, tendentially what. Okay, I'm going to conclude here and love thoughts, comments, questions on this study, but on everything I presented. So here's what we find. We find that choice and comparison sets affect the likelihood of being hired. Right, this was study one, this was the nudge study, that you can in fact create a gender equality nudge by forcing people to evaluate jointly. That's the work of Max and Alexandra. And then Farsad and I looked at the information sets available, do they affect performance? And what we find that information advantage majority groups outperform the information disadvantage groups. So that's the main effect that we find. And then very, very loosely, we relate this to the gender composition in leadership positions. This is actually how we start the paper. We motivate the paper, you know, with the data, with many of these data, you have seen this data before, and where we argue that it's exactly in these positions where women are in the minority, and where incentives are tournament style. Where either you become the CEO, or either you become the CXO, or you become, you know, the director, or not. And so we believe that, or we argue that, that is one mechanism that we may not have thought about so far, that might perpetuate these problems, because this sample clearly is quite small. In particular, as it is, as you're the only one in the company. And then it does get bigger, but not that. Thank you.